The Big Four by Agatha Christie, a Hercule Poirot mystery, narrated by John Rayburn. This book is more a spy thriller than just a mystery, as the exceptional Belgian detective Hercule Poirot gets greatly involved in international intrigue and espionage. He attempts to defeat a ruthless cartel trying to dominate the world, in essence, super criminals. Poirot's efforts include help from his closest friend, Captain Arthur Hastings, and also Inspector Japp of Scotland Yard. As we begin the tale, Hastings is just returning from a voyage at sea that he despises and is venting his displeasure as he looks forward to joining his friend. As we begin in this different manner, we hear what he was thinking as his boat came in. Chapter 1, The Unexpected Guest. Hastings was mulling it over. I have met people who enjoy a channel crossing, men who can sit calmly in their deck chairs and on arrival wait until the boat is moored, then gather their belongings together without fuss and disembark. Personally, I can never manage this. From the moment I get on board, I feel that the time is too short to settle down to anything. I move my suitcases from one spot to another, and if I go down to the saloon for a meal, I bolt my food with an uneasy feeling that the boat may arrive unexpectedly whilst I am below. Perhaps all this is merely a legacy from one's short leaves in the war, when it seemed a matter of such importance to secure a place near the gangway, and to be among the first to disembark lest one should waste precious minutes of one's 3 or 5 days' leave. On this particular July morning, as I stood by the rail and watched the white cliffs of Dover drawing nearer, I marveled at the passengers who could sit calmly in their chairs and never even raise their eyes for the first sight of their native land. Yet perhaps their case was different from mine. Doubtless many of them had only crossed to Paris for the weekend, whereas I had spent the last year and a half on a ranch in the Argentine. I had prospered there, and my wife and I had both enjoyed the free and easy life of the South American continent. Nevertheless, it was with a lump in my throat that I watched the familiar shore draw nearer and nearer. I had landed in France 2 days before, transacted some necessary business, and was now en route to London. I should be there some months, time enough to look up old friends, and one old friend in particular, a little man with an egg-shaped head and green eyes, Hercule Poirot. I proposed to take him completely by surprise. My last letter from the Argentine had given no hint of my intended voyage. Indeed, that had been decided upon hurriedly as a result of certain business complications, and I spent many amused moments picturing to myself his delight and stupefaction on beholding me. He, I knew, was not likely to be far from his headquarters. The time when his cases had drawn him from one end of England to the other was past. His fame had spread, and no longer would he allow one case to absorb all his time. He aimed more and more, as time went on, at being considered a consulting detective, as much a specialist as a Harley Street physician. He had always scoffed at the peculiar idea of the human bloodhound who assumed wonderful disguises to track criminals and who paused at every footprint to measure it. "No, my friend Hastings," he would say, "we leave that to Gerard and his friends. Hercule Poirot's methods are his own, order and method and the little gray cells. Sitting at ease in our own armchairs, we see the things that these others overlook, and we do not jump to the conclusion like the worthy Jap." No, there was little fear of finding Hercule Poirot far afield. On arrival in London, I deposited my luggage at a hotel and drove straight on to the old address. What poignant memories it brought back to me! I hardly waited to greet my old landlady, but hurried up the stairs two at a time and rapped on Poirot's door. "Enter, then," cried a familiar voice from within. I strode in. Poirot stood facing me, In his arms he carried a small valise, which he dropped with a crash on beholding me. "Mon ami Hastings," he cried, "mon ami, my friend Hastings." And rushing forward, he enveloped me in a capacious embrace. Our conversation was incoherent and inconsequent. Ejaculations, eager questions, incomplete answers, messages from my wife, explanations as to my journey, were all jumbled up together. "I suppose there's someone in my old rooms," I asked at last, when we had calmed down somewhat. "I'd love to put up here again with you." Poirot's face changed with startling suddenness. "Mon Dieu, but what bad luck! Regard around you, my friend." For the first time, I took note of my surroundings. Against the wall stood a vast arc of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.